The Words of Abinadi, probably one of my favorite prophets in the Book of Mormon. He really laid the smack down, was willing to put everything on the line. Kind of a funny story about Abinadi. When I was a young missionary in Nova Scotia, Truro, Nova Scotia, to be exact, where the Bay of Fundy comes in, just outside of Truro. It's a great town. Marky Peterson, Elder Peterson, served his mission in Truro. And I was able to read, I don't know where I got it, but it was like a booklet of his mission in Nova Scotia. And it was really interesting to read. Not a lot changed from the time he served to when I served. It is what it is, but it was awesome. But we had a little tiny branch, and we met in I can't remember if it was a Lions Club or something, but we'd have to go and clean it up from Saturday night, party, whatever it was, and it was pretty disgusting. But we had a little branch, and the people in the branch, the members there, small branch at the time I was in. So this would have been the summer that Elvis died. Very vivid in my memory, because was that 77? July or August of 77? It was summer, I know that. Every door we would knock on, which is pretty much all we did all day long, was knock on doors. Not that effective, but very entertaining. But we placed a lot of copies of the Book of Mormon and hopefully planted some seeds, sowed some seeds, if you will. Anyway, during this time, the reason why I bring up Elvis is that women, this was back in the day when, even in Canada, it was more traditional of men worked and women took care of the home and children at home. And so quite often during the day of knocking on doors, it would be women. Well, when Elvis died, they were just bawling. I mean, bawling. And you could actually hear the wails as you would come up to the door, And quite often, at least this part of Canada, you'd have a picture of Kennedy, John F. Kennedy, and then you'd have a picture of Elvis, and then you'd have a picture of the Queen of England. and sometimes the Elvis one was like one on the velvet, the velvet painting, but everybody loved Elvis. And I actually am a fan of Elvis, especially his gospel music that he did. Anyway, totally off track there, but in this little branch, Abinadi was known as Abinadi. And my companion, Elder, I'll think of his name in just a second here, Elder Vandertulen. If you're out there, brother, I'd love to hear from you. But Elder Vandertulen, who was in Truro, Nova Scotia, probably in 1977, if you're out there, or if somebody knows him, I think he was from Clearfield or Centerville or Bountiful or something like that. I can't remember, but just a great, great companion. But I was a young, pretty new missionary. Not really, but I'd been out a while, but anyway, less than a year. I wanted to correct these members and tell them that it's Abinadi, it's not Abinadi. And Elder Vandertulen just calmly, he goes, "Elder, we really don't know. Let's just let him call it what, Abinadi." So quite often, we'll in our household, we refer to him as Abinadi. But Abinadi, or Abinadi, many, In fact, this is what prompted a video I did a couple ago. Is you know, we don't hear, you know, the thus saith the Lord's as often anymore. But Abinadi, it was repeated over and over and over and over again when he spoke. He said this came from the Lord. So it's pretty interesting. There's a couple of things I want to point out with Abinadi, and because there's some great teaching here in addition to very forceful and prophecy concerning destruction of the wicked. But one thing I want to talk about is this idea. We've talked about this before on this channel, but I think sometimes it needs to be repeated. And that is that not everyone goes to the highest kingdom. There isn't just one kingdom and everyone eventually gets there. This is somehow this teaching has infiltrated the church. And obviously this is just my opinion, but it's Abinadi makes it very clear that salvation and exaltation, salvation, you know, we have a lot of different meanings of what does salvation mean, what does exaltation mean? And Abinadi is very specific about this. But it does get confusing, and so I do get that. So, where we want to start with this is in Messiah chapter 14, and this is where we have Isaiah 53, which is one of the greatest chapters, messianic verses of Scripture that just pinpoints the Savior, and a lot of messianic Jews point to this specific scripture as they're talking to Orthodox Jewish rabbis and say, you know, what does this mean? Now, Rashi, who was a rabbi in medieval times, I think it was, he said that Isaiah 53 had to do with the house of Israel, that it would be wounded, that it would be that would bear the griefs and all this, that this would be the house of Israel, which, you know, in a sense it's true, but it's so clear that this is talking about Jesus Christ, Isaiah 53. So he gets through this, and here's where we sometimes can think that Christ suffered and atoned for everyone's sins, regardless if they repented or not. So in verse 4, surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities, the chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquities of us all. So that sounds like that would include everybody. Everyone's iniquity upon him. Seems pretty clear. I think the key word in there is us. Who that this was revealed to Isaiah, who is us? Is it everybody or is it his seed? Is it his seed? And we have to keep reading, and who are his seed? So we have to keep reading the words of Isaiah, and we have to include, and Abinadi, but we have to include all the verses, because in verse 12, it might sound like a little bit of a controversy or an opposite of what we just read. But if we read verse 12, therefore I will divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bore the sins of many, not all, but many. and made intercession for the transgressors. So now we have, he bore the sins of many versus the Lord hath laid on him the iniquities of us all. So then we have to decide who us is. So they seem to contradict each other a little bit, but they really don't if you continue to read. So here we are. Let's go over to, we're still in 15. It's a good long chapter. And this is what Abinadi says in verse 10 of Messiah 15. And now I say unto you, who shall declare his generation? Behold, I say unto you that when his soul has been made an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. And now what say ye? Who shall be his seed? So here we go. This is the us, okay, that Isaiah is referring to, his seed. Behold, I say unto you that whosoever has heard the words of the prophets, and we're going to talk about this a lot in this video, yea, all the holy prophets who have prophesied concerning the coming of the Lord. So this is specific prophecy of prophets concerning the coming of the Lord. I say unto you that all those who have hearkened unto their words and believed that the Lord would redeem his people and have looked forward to that day for a remission of their sins, I say unto you that these are his seed, or they are the heirs of the kingdom of God. So this gets very specific. And then verse 12 is really kind of the chiasmus. It's the center of this thought. For these are they whose sins he has borne. So now we're getting to a specific group of whose sins he felt or borne. And I've done two or three videos on all the scriptures that point this out. But we're talking about Abinadi, and we're talking about his preaching to wicked King Noah and the wicked priests. So let's just keep reading, because I want to read verse 13 too. So verse 12 again, for these are they whose sins he has borne. These are they for whom he has died, to redeem them from their transgressions. And now are they not his seed? Now listen to verse 13. This kind of helps us understand. Sometimes we call them the small p prophets, but it really helps us understand the Old Testament version of a prophet. It might not be a leader of a church or a group of people. It could be an individual that God just said, you're it, and you're going to go speak. When we first read the words of Abinadi, it just says a man came forth. You know, it's pretty interesting if you see the introduction of Abinadi. But let's read verse 13 now. Yea, and are not the prophets everyone that has opened his mouth to prophesy, that has not fallen into transgression? I mean all the holy prophets ever since the world began. I say unto you that they are his seed. So basically we're all prophets in that sense. If we don't fall into iniquity and we acknowledge that Christ is our Lord and our Savior, our Redeemer, and that he is coming. Okay, and verse 14, and these are they who have published peace, who have brought good tidings of good, who have published salvation and said unto Zion, thy God reigneth. Now see what he's doing is Abinadi's coming back to what the wicked priest said, like, hey, aren't you supposed to be publishing glad tidings of peace and joy and all that kind of stuff. And here you are telling us we're going to be destroyed because we're wicked. And then Abinadi brings that scripture back and puts it in the context, of what it actually is saying, what Isaiah is actually saying. So the condition of his seed, the condition of his people, and as Isaiah was saying, us, yes, Christ suffered for the sins of those who repented, now, saving from death, that's when it gets more inclusive of everyone who's born. They will have the opportunity to be resurrected, right? Okay, now, verse 18, and behold, I say unto you, I'm still in Mosiah 15, and behold, I say unto you, this is not all, for oh, how beautiful upon the mountain are the feet of him that bringeth good tidings, that is the founder of peace, yea, even the Lord who has redeemed his people, yea, him whom who has granted salvation unto his people. Okay, for were it not for the redemption which he made for his people, which was prepared from the foundations of the world. Anyway, it goes on. So we have us, we have his seed and his people. And these are the sins that he suffered from. Now, I have a quote. I don't have it right handy here, but this is from a Mission President seminar by President Oaks a year, maybe it was last year. It might have been 2 years ago, but I think it was last year with the Mission President Conference in July. And he specifically said the suffering of repented sins, Christ's suffering for repented sins. So it's pretty fascinating to think about that. And how Abinadi taught this and how it's taught all through the Book of Mormon, this conditional suffering that Christ did and that he redeems those that repent and follow him. And this gets into a lot of things about the covenant path. What is the covenant? What is the covenant? What is the covenant? The covenant can be so many different things. And for me, you really have to narrow it down in order for it to make sense. Now, some would say the covenant is faith in Christ, basically the doctrine of Christ, faith in Christ and his atonement, repenting of our sins, being baptized, receiving the Holy Ghost, and continuing or enduring to the end, right? Continuing on the covenant path, okay? Which is, I'm fine with. That's okay. That's a covenant. But I think we have to identify even more than that. This is just my opinion, because we have to go to the Abrahamic covenant. That's the covenant of covenants. And it's the same covenant that Adam had and Noah had, Enoch had, but it had to be renewed through Abraham and then Isaac and then Jacob and then on down. And in the sealing, we're given all the blessings of the Abrahamic covenant. We're giving all the blessings of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That covenant has to do with having the priesthood, the blessing of God's authority in your life, and the gospel. It's the blessing of posterity, increase. This is eternal lives, not just eternal life, but eternal lives, as it says in the Doctrine and Covenants. And then property. And quite often property is left out. We don't like to say as a church, you know, we believe in the Abrahamic covenant and we believe we're going to have a lot of posterity and a lot of property. And it's going to be the New Jerusalem if you're in the Americas. And Israel is the promised land and part of the covenant land for Israel there. And you can see reasons why property isn't brought up or a land inheritance, but it's all through the Book of Mormon. It's all through the Book of Mormon. The land, the property, the area, is a covenant land. It's a covenant land. And people that believe in God the Father, His Son Jesus Christ, I think this is open, this is my opinion. I don't think you have to be a baptized member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints in order to experience blessings of the Abrahamic covenant. But I do think you have to believe in God and His Son Jesus Christ in order to inherit the land and to have posterity and to participate in some form of authority or I'm trying to think of the right word that I want to use. The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints is God's kingdom on earth, restored through the prophet Joseph Smith and subsequently keys held by President Nelson, the first presidency in the Quorum of the Twelve. I understand that, but there is power, perhaps not authority, so power is probably the word I'm looking for, in a belief in Christ, His atonement, turning to Him, acknowledging His sonship to the Father, acknowledging His redemptive power in the garden and on the cross. There's power in that, and that's part of the Abrahamic covenant, in my opinion. But then there's this property thing. So when we have the opportunity to read the Book of Mormon, as we're studying it now, and we always have the opportunity, right? But right now, this is our focus as a church, as a people, to studying the Book of Mormon. I think it's imperative that we think of what is the covenant? What is the covenant and what does it consist of? Because we always say, oh, a covenant, it's a two-way promise. You know, God promises something and in return, we promise to do something. Well, the covenant, what God promises to us has a direct tie of what we do for Him. They're not just like, okay, you're going to do this, this, and this, and then I'm going to give you in return things that are totally unrelated to what you're doing. So if it is the Abrahamic covenant, which I believe, then posterity is one of those things. Well, you know, if you're part of the alphabet soup, the posterity thing is kind of thrown out the window. That's part of keeping the covenant. If you're promised a power or authority and the gospel of Jesus Christ in your life, and you're not participating in that, then you're not going to receive that specific blessing. So this is really the covenant. How am I trying to say this? We're to be doing those very things that God has promised us. We're to be doing the things that are associated with that. There's a scripture, I think it's, there's a law irrevocably decreed in heaven before the foundations of the world upon which all blessings are predicated. And when we obtain any blessing from God is by obedience to the law upon which it is predicated. So these things are attached. They're connected. You get this promise from God by doing this, but what we're doing is directly related to what we're promised. I hope that's making sense. So if we say we're going to be blessed with posterity, but we do nothing to facilitate that, it doesn't make much sense, does it? It's not fulfilled. Now look, there's a lot of different situations and people have situations where that might not be possible right now. And you know, that those are the exceptions, and let's not throw everything out because of the exceptions. God will handle that. He'll take care of that. There'll be opportunities somehow, some way, I'm convinced, because that's part of the Abrahamic covenant. And this earth life is just this, it's just one phase of our existence. It's one phase. And somehow, some way, that will be made right. Okay. Young children die. They never have that chance. Certain people, for whatever reason, they don't marry, they can't marry, or they physically can't have children. There's all kinds of things. But for the most part, guys, let's not always go to the exceptions so we're worried about offending people. That's not what the Lord did. He gave overall blessings, okay? And that's how we have to approach things. Being mindful that there's always, if someone is obedient and doing everything they can, opportunities, probably during the millennial reign is what I'm thinking, because I think it has to do with the earth, this earth, and property on this earth, and the gospel, which will be the kingdom of heaven during the millennium, not the kingdom of God. So this property thing is something I think we ought to think about. I'd like to hear it in the comment section of what that means. If we live the gospel of Jesus Christ and we have turn our lives over to the God of Israel, just as Abraham did, and said, I'll do whatever you want me to do. And in return, he's going to promise us a posterity, he's going to promise us property, and he's going to promise us the priesthood and his authority and power to do things in his name. What does the property mean? Are we going to get a bunch of land? The land of Israel, the promised land that Lehi came to, what does that really mean? For me, it means absolutely what it's saying. The land of Israel was given to Abraham and then to Isaac and then to Jacob, and it is the promised land, and it will be restored. We have scripture after scripture after scripture that they will inherit their land. That prophecy in the latter days, and that prophecy was fulfilled in 1947 and then again in 1967, the Six-Day War. And it's just been fought over, and it's just there, and it's not going away. And it is the land of Israel, and it is their land. Well, what does that have to do with the remnant of Joseph that came here to the Americas? And what does that mean? The property, because that's part of the Abrahamic covenant, but it's not mentioned very often. And I think one of the reasons is it might sound like we're going to take it over. And that's what the early saints faced all the time, because they did preach that, hey, this is promised to us. And then the people around would go, well, wait a minute, we were here first and you're not going to take it from us. And of course, if you read and study the Bible, you know that as Joshua entered to cross the River Jordan and went into Jericho, it was like, guess what, guys? We're the covenant people, and we're coming in and we're taking over. And it was all commanded by God that would happen. So I suspect something similar to that will take place. And it's just, you know, it's something to think about. If you think otherwise, that that's not going to happen, I would like to have a scriptural basis for that and not just, throwing out an opinion. But those are his people, his seed. Those are the promises of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. God bless. We'll talk to you soon. Bye-bye.